Hello friends, today we will start with chapter 18, sound, that is production of sound. Okay, so now you just take the boxes of what you have seen. Okay, I think most of the people would have a fair share experience with this and not to think this. Okay, these two would have been done by everyone. Okay, so basically as we see that sound is generated due to a variety of events, you cannot assign a particular source to the sound. Okay, in some example, sound was generated due to vibration of an object. Okay, you basically, when you ring that bell, if you see that the outside, if this is the external of the bell and this is the ghanta what we press, this vibrates, the outer one vibrates. Okay, for example, the bell or the strings, the one who plays guitar or sitar will know that strings also generate sound, or diaphragm of a musical instrument. Okay, while in some example like bursting a cracker, etc., vibrations are not felt, but actually they are generated. Okay, if you wait, you see, even if you, as the plate comes down, it's a very strong dum sound and then a light sound you will see. Okay, all these vibrations are imparted to the molecules in the air and sound is produced. Okay, for example, here is a string and it moves, the air surrounding it moves and we hear a particular sound. Okay, like the example if the given is, it's a lake. You throw a stone inside and it generates ripples. Okay, so that is how the sounds, they from source, they reach our ear through vibrations. Okay, now as they say that now for tuning the instrument, what you do is you adjust how tight or how loose the string is to be. Okay, so if any one of you has attended live music, so they will know how each and everything is set up before it starts. Okay, so what happen is when tanpura, the strings are adjusted. Okay, for example, I have to play sur sa. Okay, not the rakshasi sur sa, I have to play sa, or I have to play suppose re. Okay, so string will have to adjust with the sa or the re of the tanpura. Similarly, a tabla, the diaphragm, basically if you have ever seen a tabla, it's something, okay, not, it looks like a bucket, but that's how the shape of a tabla is. The upper part of the membrane, often you set it, I mean it's often tightened and loosened, okay, by hammering in a tabla. So harmonium, the different what do you call, I can't remember it, the key, yeah, the key of the harmonium is different for different tones. So what will happen is, for so to tune an instrument, everything is adjusted finally. So for Indian music, the notes are sa, re, ga, ma, pa, dha, ni. Okay, so as I say, in scientific terms, frequency is a measure of pitch. Okay, so now we see how sound is generated, how it reaches us, how by traveling through the some medium and is heard by us. Now here you learn more about what we learn: vibration, pitch, intensity and level of sound. Okay, so let us begin. So now as I say that, okay, now let's zoom it into this veena. So what happens is, okay, now I think I better draw my own diagram. When you are playing any stringed instrument, it can be guitar, it can be sitar, it can be tanpura, it can be veena. This is valid for all the stringed instrument. What you do is you fix the string at these two ends. Okay, now string won't move at these two ends, but when you strum it, the spring rotates here. That's how it rotates. Okay, so as I say, the strings seem to vibrate, but the two ends are still. They do not move. Okay, so basically, as you have seen, I said it's something like this motion. Okay, that is with respect to time. The string first moves here, then 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 here. Sort of this kind of motion. So as they say, how do you find it in words? One side of the central position and comes back to the central position. Okay? This motion is repeated again and again. And the amplitudes are more or less equal. Here I have drawn it unequal. Okay? Such motion is called periodic motion. Okay, any motion which repeats itself after a defined period of time is a periodic motion. Okay? Now, as they say, this is a thing. Sound is generated by rhythmic vibration. Okay, anything that vibrates produces sound. Now, we can hear the sound as long as it's vibrating. Okay, for example, this is the two ends of the string. As long as the string is rotating about its position, you hear, but as you touch, you make the vibration stationary. Now the string is not vibrating and so you don't hear the sound. Or sometimes the vibrations happen, but they are actually so minute that we cannot hear them. Okay. Now let's come to oscillator, oscillation and oscillatory motion. Okay, now oscillation is, if you have ever seen a pendulum, okay, this is its normal position. Now as it rotates, it goes there, then again there, then again. Okay, so it is oscillate, it is present around one mean position. It does not leave that particular position. Okay, this is what oscillatory is. Okay, so here we have an example of swing. Okay, and a swing moves back and forth like this is an oscillator. Similarly, the exam I defined it in terms of pendulum. Okay, so when the swing moves from one end to the other and returns to its starting point, it is said to have completed one oscillation. What you do is you leave it from here, it completes this and it comes back here. This is a one oscillation. Okay, the back and forth motion of an oscillator on either side of central position is called oscillatory motion. Okay, so basically, what is an oscillator? An oscillator is any object that moves back and forth with respect to a central position. Okay, I am defining basically these three terms. Okay, oscillation is when the back and forth movement happens only one. That is, where we started, we come back to that point, it is an oscillation. And the motion of oscillator is called oscillatory motion. Fine. Okay, yeah, here is an example given of swing. It stays around one position. So now what you do is take an empty porcelain bowl and a steel glass, stretch a rubber band and put it like something like this. Place it there. What you do is you press the rubber band and throw it. It starts to rotate. Okay. And as it rotates like this. Okay. Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. Okay. So, what happens is, okay. So, when the rubber is stretched from original position A to position B, okay, maybe not is that case. Let me take a separate case. From its position A to position B, it is seen to be curved. the maximum distance between, for example, you press the rubber, then it goes up. Okay, now from neutral position, it is what amplitude is. Okay, if this is the zero point, this is the amplitude. Okay, amplitude will be clear when we define it in terms of pendulum later ahead. Okay, so as I said, when you, if you press it harder, it will, for example, if you pressed it softly, then it will be like this. You pressed harder, then it will be more like this. Okay, so basically amplitude is depends on the force. So as I say, on stretching it further, it means amplitude increases. On releasing it, a louder sound is generated. Okay, for smaller force, the rubber is stretched less. The amplitude is smaller and sound is softer. Okay, now do this experiment as a given example of a pendulum. Okay, the maximum distance between original position A and extreme position B or C is called amplitude, because A is a neutral position. So here AB or AC gives the amplitude. Okay, now let's come to time period and frequency. Now this is an important concept of an oscillation, because whenever you say the object is oscillating, the first question that anyone will ask will be, what is the time period? Okay, now taking an example of the pendulum there, okay, basically what is time period? For example, I released this ball at B. Okay, so the time that takes, okay, let me take C, here they give in respect to B. That really doesn't matter. The thing is, it should be at the same position. Okay, let me take it at B. It will avoid any sort of confusion later. Okay, it's at B. Okay, and then I released it. What happened is, it goes from B to A, then A to C, and again from C to A, and C to B. The time that take place for this to reach the position from which it was released, that is from B to B, this is called the time period. Okay, so as they say, from B to central position A and from there to the position C, then again back to A and from A to B, the time required to traverse this oscillation BA, CAB is the time period of the oscillator. Okay, this is how time period is defined. And what is frequency? The number of oscillations completed by an oscillator in 1 second is called frequency of the oscillation. Okay, for example, if the pendulum vibrate, say B to B motion happens 3 times, and the frequency is 3 hertz. Okay, similarly, if it happens only once, example once in a second, then it is 1 hertz. Okay, hertz is a unit of frequency. Okay, so what is frequency f? Frequency is defined by a term short n and is given by 1 upon time period. Okay, and the unit is hertz. Basically, 1 hertz means 1 oscillation per second, and 100 hertz means 100 oscillations per second. Okay, now here is a case, you can explain it by diagram. Basically, what you have to do is take a scale and arrange it such that most of its part lies on the table. Now press that end and release it. Okay, it starts to vibrate. Now similarly, increase the free end and reduce the end on the table. And do that again. Press it and then release. Press it, then release. Press it, then release. What one thing you will notice was that the more the free end, the more the scale goes up and down. Okay, so The above is the observation. This is explained that in words. Now what is, also take note of what happens, okay, and record that. Okay, let me define a bit. What happened will be that as you increase the free end, the amplitude will increase. That is, if it does move a bit here, then from there it will move here. Basically, it will show a large variations, okay, because it has more length available. Okay, now again try this. Okay, this is something which is a calculation part. I'll explain the experiment, but the thing is, the value is dependent on lot of external factors. Okay, what you do is take a thread, attach a ball to it, okay, and then make it to an extreme position and then throw it. Okay, so observe. So suppose if you have left the pendulum from here, okay, so count this as one oscillation and record the time for 20 oscillations. Okay, that how much time does it take to complete 20 oscillation, basically the number of times it touches this position. Okay, and then time period is given by t by 20 and frequency is given by 1 by t. Okay, we take 20 oscillations because if we take only one, there are high chances of error. So when you take more observations, the error chances are reduced. Okay. Now what you do is, okay, so what you do had to do here in the above experiment was you had to vary the length. Okay, for example, if it was 10 centimeter, then 20, then 30, then 40. And observe what effect does this length have on time period. Now what you do is keep the length fixed, okay, but vary the amplitude. Basically, if it was here, it's a high amplitude, assuming this is the main position. Okay, so this is high, this is a bit less, and this is very low. Okay, basically leave the point here and observe. Okay, now as you will see, as you can understand through basic observation, is the more the amplitude is less, so it will take lesser time. Okay, because here it has to complete this whole way, and from here it has to complete just this. Okay, so lesser amplitude means lesser time, and lesser time implies more frequency. So as they say, the time period of an oscillation depends upon the length of pendulum. Okay, the time of oscillation increases if the length of pendulum is increased. Now what I had said above is what most of you would be thinking. But the thing is, the frequency remains the same even if amplitude decreases or increases. Okay, so basically to explain my point, what I thought was what most of you would think would happen. But the thing is, now when it is closer, the 20 oscillation time, the speed is slower. If you place it here, the speed is faster. Okay, so there's virtually no difference in the time it takes, because speed more or less manages to compensate the time. Okay, so never do that mistake thinking that less amplitude means lesser frequency. Amplitude and frequency are practically independent of each other. Okay. Now, a pitch. Basically, if I have to explain in one line what's a pitch, so if I have to give an example, so please don't get scared. This is a high pitch sound, and this is a low pitch sound. Okay. Basically, one line explanation, but anyhow, that's not a scientific explanation. Okay, so to observe that, do a calculation, an experiment. Take a board 80 to 90 centimeter long and 5 centimeter wide. Okay, we have taken a board, hammer two nails at the end of it. Okay, there are the two nails, each a few centimeter away from its two ends. Okay, they are away. Tie the ends of a metal wire into the nails so that the wire is stretched tightly between them. Okay. Insert a wedge-shaped wooden or a plastic block under the wire. Okay, this is the setup we have prepared, and now we plug the wire. Okay, fair enough. Okay, now what we have to do is we have to insert. Okay, remember initially it was only this wedge. This rectangle is not there. So what you do is insert this rectangle. But remember, the length of wire shouldn't change. Now if you don't have to change the length of the wire, you will have to loosen it at one end. Okay, now what happens is you plug the wire again and listen to the sound. Now you notice the difference with it. Okay, when tension in the wire is increased, remember, because length has not changed. Okay, this block came in between, but if it was a bit loose, it's now tighter. So basically tension in wire is increased. The frequency is seen to increase. Okay, let me again define what was the tension, wire tension increased. Basically, suppose this is a wire which has no restriction on it, it's loose, no issues. But if it is stretched, it becomes straighter, tension increases. When there was only the wedge block, the wire was stretched but not that stretched. But when you place a rectangular box near it, the wire stretched even more. So the tension increased. And as you will observe, the frequency increases. Okay, and as the tension is reduced, frequency seem to reduce. Okay. And so we perceive this difference in the sound generated. Okay. And as I say, when tension is increased, the resulting sound is shriller. Basically, shriller is something that is, if I have to say, irritating to ears. Okay, the tension is reduced, the sound is also less shrill. Okay, this is what is called the high and low pitch of sound. Okay, basically remember that the shrill sound has nothing to do with being loud. Okay, even a low amplitude voice can be shrill. It depends entirely on the frequency. Okay, well, as they say, which of the sounds, the roar of a lion or the hum of a mosquito, has the higher pitch? Now, thing is that mosquito's voice are like shrill. They're like, how to explain? They're like, okay, I can't produce that noise. Basically, how girls shout. Okay, I know that's a really bad example. Or I don't have anyone shout. Like, basically, that's a pitch. So, mosquito has a high pitch. Basically, and roar of a lion, it's more like, it's less shriller, it's more diffused, it's more deep. Okay, so the mosquito has a higher pitch. So what structure in sitar help to produce higher or lower pitch sound? Basically, if you have ever seen a sitar, there are ends with you which you can vary the length. Okay, so it can help you to produce higher or lower pitch sound. Okay, so let's come to intensity, sound level. So, loudness or softness is indicated by two terms, intensity of sound and sound level. Okay. Basically, they may assume to be same, but they are different. Sound level is the intensity of sound as perceived by our ears. Okay. Basically, how our ears listen is the sound level. Notice intensity, it is proportional to square of amplitude of vibration. Okay, so basically these two things are different. Okay, it may happen that our ears may perceive the sound to having less amplitude when it may have more amplitude. Okay, so the left box gives an idea about, you know, the numbers of how, what is a typical decibel amplitude. Okay, so what is a decibel? So it is the unit for measuring sound levels. Okay, invented by the honor of Greek Alexander Graham Bell. Okay, the decibel can be deduced from intensity of sound using a mathematical formula. Okay, basically there is a relation between decibel and intensity. Okay, and when this becomes 10 times the original, it increases into 10 times, it increases by plus 10. Okay, there is a relation which is actually a bit of a complex mathematical relationships, so I won't go much into detail. Okay, now the audible and inaudible sound. Okay, not much of a difference. That audible sound is what we humans can hear. It is between 20 hertz and 20,000 hertz. Anything beyond that, we cannot hear it. Okay, infrasonic sound, which is, okay, it's not, the number is not here, maybe defined later, below 20 hertz. Anything less than 20 hertz is infrasonic. Okay. Have you ever heard the sound of movement of our hands or of the movement of leaf falling from the tree? Okay, kind of, we have. Okay, now the thing is, the oscillator makes 3 to 4 oscillation in 1 second, means that the frequency is of 3 to 4 hertz and we cannot hear that. Okay, that is why actually we cannot hear the pendulum. Okay, because for every 1 second, the pendulum goes back to its original position. Okay, so it has a frequency of 1 hertz. So we will never see a pendulum making a noise, but simply because we cannot hear it. Okay. So in the above example, basically at 3 to 4 hertz, oscillations did take place, but no sound was heard because it was less than 20 hertz. But animals like whales, elephants and rhinoceros can hear it. In fact, so much so they say that ocean, because whales use infrared signal, infrasonic signals. Okay, what was the name? Yeah, waves use infrasonic sound to communicate amongst them. So they say the ocean is really noisy, but since much of it is infrasonic sound, we humans do not hear it. So what is ultrasonic sound? Anything above 20,000 hertz is ultrasonic. We again cannot hear, but dogs can hear this sound really, really well. Okay. So as I say, elephants also communicate with each other using infrasonic sound. So now the thing is, ultrasonic sound is used for some applications. Okay. To clean delicate ornaments and the tiny parts of a watch. Okay, so ultrasonic sound, basically what happens is, how do I explain? Just wait for a moment. Basically, you can say that energy is proportional to frequency. Okay, we will learn that relation why in higher class. So basically, ultrasonic waves are high energy waves. Okay, so we have to clean some delicate instrument or some delicate ornament that basically you cannot clean by any chemical because it will destroy it. But what happens is, ultrasonic frequencies are enough to remove dirt but not damage it. Okay, 2 to observe internal organs, 3 to detect tumors, 4th to detect faults, 5th in radar system. The bulk purpose of the ultrasonic sound is in radar. 6th, to kill certain microbes and insects. Okay, basically if the amplitude of ultrasonic sound is very high, it is harmful to practically every living organism, including us. So okay, so one should never be explained to high ultrasonic sounds. Okay. 7th, used in sonar, basically to navigate the position of ship in the seabed. Okay, so this table gives the frequency. So blue whales communicate infrasonic while dolphins communicate in ultrasonic. Okay, I hope the chapter was clear. Thank you.